Hello, and welcome to the first ever episode of Game and Learn. I'm your host, Dr. Bryan Carr. Not only am I an assistant professor of communications and information science here at the University of Wisconsin-Green Bay, I'm also the advisor for the brand new Game Studies emphasis. And I thought, you know, when we talk about video games, we're talking about something that has at its core a lot of intersections between art and knowledge and culture. And so I thought, what better way to celebrate the multifaceted aspects of game studies than to sit down with some of the greatest people on earth, the faculty and staff here at the University of Wisconsin-Green Bay, as well as some other folks and friends from around this community and other communities. So since it's our first ever episode and we're gonna sit down and talk about these issues while we play video games, I thought, you know, it's football season, excitement's in the air, we're in Titletown, baby. So what better way to kick things off than by playing Madden NFL 17 with my good friend and chair of the psychology department here at UWGB, Dr. Ryan Martin, who, in addition to having just won the Fellows Award for teaching excellence, or sorry, the Founders Award for teaching excellence here, is also a nationally recognized expert on anger and has written a lot on sports fandom. So are you ready, Dr. Martin?
You bet. Let's do this.
Well, this is going to get awkward. And here we are in the studio at UWGB. I am, of course, your host, Bryan Carr. With me, once again, as we saw in the beginning, that very awkward beginning, is our head of psychology here, our chair of the psychology department, and just won the Founders Award for teaching excellence. Congratulations. Very good work, sir. Well deserved.
Thank you very much.
Ryan Martin.
Hey, thanks for having me. This is exciting. I haven't played this game in a very long time.
So. Yeah, it's you know, it's one of those things that if you skip like 10 years, it changes a lot.
Okay.
But if you see it year after year after year, not that much really changes.
What about 8 years? So is that a long time?
I think you'd see a pretty big difference.
Because I think the version I have at home is 2008, so maybe 2009.
Yeah, I mean, you know, buttons show up over the guy's heads. You hit the button to throw it to him. It's that kind of stuff.
Good.
So
good.
I think you'll be able to get the swing of it, but whatever. We're all friends here. Yeah. So this, of course, is Madden NFL 17. Just came out on August 23rd. A lot of different things you can do in this game. Of course, if you want to give Electronic Arts more money, you can jump into Madden Ultimate Team and you can give them, you buy cards to like create your own sort of fantasy football lineup. But what we're probably going to do is we're just going to go ahead and jump right into the play now. While this is loading, of course, what we want to talk about today is the question of sports fandom. Of course, we live in Titletown. This is Green Bay Packer country, yeah. Which makes, again, you know, we love you anyway. I'm from Michigan. I'm technically a Lions fan, but like you don't really want to give that.
No,
you don't
want to
say that. It's hard.
Yeah.
It's not so much hard to admit. It's mostly just people feel bad for you.
Yeah.
And I after a while that gets tiring. So I decided, you know what, I'll adopt the local
Sounds
color.
Good.
What is it about sports fan? Because I've noticed that you know, just from a casual observer, certainly not someone who's approaching it from your level, I've noticed that sports fandom makes people kind of go crazy. Like, they get really closely and personally invested in sports teams and players and that sort of thing. So what exactly is it about sports, like NFL, like baseball, that sort of thing, that cause people to do that?
Well, so much of it has to do with why you got involved and invested in a team in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so because they have pretty serious connections for people. I mean, a lot of times this is someone's avenue to connect with friends, it's
mm-hmm.
someone's avenue to connect with their family. You know, it's, for a lot of people, it has to do with upbringing and kind of connections.
Right.
So I'm just going to go on record as saying the effects are pretty impressive.
They look good, right?
Sorry.
Yeah.
Taking a little break here. So you're going to see some awing, some moments of awe from me simply because I haven't done this for a while.
Yeah.
But what I would say is is a big part of it is that, okay, so you're raised maybe around a particular sport, and then that sport reflects a connection to maybe your parents or maybe your friends or your community and things like that. And I think family is really interesting. You know, I talk to people who will tell me that one of the things that they really had, that one of the ways that...
You
got to do stuff.
So I'm going to kick, and you're going to return.
Okay.
So this is one of the new things in this one, and not to interrupt, but we are kind of playing live as we go. But so I'm going to kick, and then he's going to go ahead and catch it. But so we're talking about family. Of course, you are. Are you from the Minnesota area?
I am. Yeah.
So that would explain a lot, right? Like this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. No, I am. And you know, for me, it's interesting. Part of it's family. My brothers, my sister, my mom and dad, especially my dad, we're big Vikings fans. And so there was a big part of it that was a connection there. But for me, it's actually more friends.
Mm-hmm.
This is actually one of the ways I keep in touch with some of my best friends from high school. It's, you know, we watch games and we sort of watch them together by texting mm-hmm. each other during. And,
so now you can pick pick your own play if you want. I like to just go with the coach suggestion because I'm lazy. So it used to be what Madden would tell you to do, but since Madden's kind of retired,
gotcha.
He just puts his name on it and cashes the checks. He doesn't actually do any actual work.
Good for him.
So here's your first snap. Just hit A to snap the ball, and so you're going to be looking for a guy to throw it to, and there you go. And, yeah, not bad.
Right.
So, yeah, and you can also, like, hit different buttons or different kinds of catches, but we'll keep it simple for right now.
Good.
Right. Yeah.
So where is the coaches?
Oh, you can hit B to go back. Yeah. And one more time, and just go up to coach suggestions. There you go.
Okay. Gotcha.
Yeah, so that like I said, that's probably the easiest way to go, and you can just get different specific recommendations. And another thing I've noticed that, and this kind of ties into that whole notion that you had of your sort of personal connection to this, when people talk about sports, they always use the term we. Now, of course, I know a lot of Packers fans around here. They're not out there on the field every Sunday. But what is it about this kind of pronoun usage, right? And you see a lot of people kind of get mocked for this, but there's something deeper, right?
Yeah, this is actually what social psychologists refer to as basking in reflected glory or burging. Basically it means when you...
So I know this is the tricky part with this show.
It basically means that, you know, when you have a connection to a team or, and frankly, it doesn't work. Oh, that was not a good play.
Yeah. He got knocked down.
When you have a... look at this sportsmanship.
Yeah, they're very nice. This is not at all like the actual NFL,
no,
for the record. This is very much the sanitized, family-friendly version of the NFL.
When you have a... asking in reflected glory,
yeah.
When you identify with a group,
mm-hmm.
And this happens actually in politics, mm-hmm. It happens in a host of places, you start to kind of take on the identity, and so you,
I almost caught it.
Yep.
So you bask in the reflected glory, and so essentially what they do on the field, does that kind of like almost act as a proxy for your own self-worth?
Yep, exactly. So you're identifying with them when they have success. You want to bask in that glory, and
mm-hmm.
So you bask in the reflected glory of that.
Yeah, there's a couple different options you got here. I won't look at the screen. That's like one thing you definitely can't do.
Right.
And it's hard kind of given the situation because we're like elbow to elbow right here. But I promise I won't look at the screen. Okay, so you're going to go ahead and punt. So you hit A to start it, and then hit A to set the power, and then A to set the accuracy. And so that's not a bad punt. It's not bad. I've seen worse. I've done worse, but it's going to go out of bounds.
Oh.
So.
Yeah, it might have been a little hard.
Yeah.
Okay. Now
yeah.
So the other side of that, though, is what they call porfing, or cutting off reflecting failure.
Mm-hmm.
And this is when... this is when people like basically you've got your team doesn't do as well as you want them to.
Yeah,
and,
like that right there.
Yeah. Your team doesn't do as well as you want to, and so you stop using the pronoun.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you start talking about them as that.
Yeah,
know,
like those bums, those clowns.
They played terrible
yeah.
today.
Yep.
And so on, and so we see kind of both sides of it.
Yeah. Now, what's kind of interesting, of course, we just had the Olympics, and I noticed that, you know, because I know I did this a lot, too. Whenever, you know, like, you have, like, Ryan Phelps, or Michael Phelps, I'm sorry, I'm getting my swimmers mixed up.
Oh, I think you were talking about me.
Yeah, yeah, right. Well, I've never seen you swim. You could be great.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you have Michael Phelps going out there and just doing ridiculous amounts of swimming at very high speeds, they, like, it's very tempting to say, yeah, we did that, we're America, we're great, but it's, in reality, it's about as far from a we as you can get, because it's one guy out there, right?
Right.
And I don't know if, like, almost like nationality or regionality plays some role in that.
I think it definitely does. I mean, and that's one of the things that, you know, the Olympics does, is they obviously build up the role of nationality and
right.
coverage, you know, trying to invite the Olympics. I mean, NBC, you know, really tries to build that component up, allows you to identify with the players and the athletes. One of the things that the Olympics doesn't do as much anymore, and this is purely my perception, is that they don't seem to build up an outgroup the mm-hmm. same way like the NFL does. There's, you know, the bad guy.
Right.
My suspicion is that is something I didn't watch a whole lot of Olympics. Oh, no.
Yes, go on. Yeah.
Okay. That was not ideal. So
that was a great outcome for me.
I didn't watch a whole lot of Olympics during the Cold War.
Right.
But I suspect that there was a lot more building up of a bad guy during that.
Well, because you had Russia was kind of like this built-in villain, right?
Right. And you had, you know, two Olympics where, you know, people boycotted, or their countries boycotted because of that. So there was like a natural villain. I mean, you take the 1980 hockey as an example, right?
Right.
There was a really clear in-group, as we call it, you know, this group that you psychologically identify with, and a really clear out-group, you know, this group that, you know, is essentially the presence of
sort of like an early precursor to, like, the axis of evil and that kind of stuff. Well,
and that's what you see with, you know, the NFL, I mean, real clear presence of an in-group and an out-group. You've got one of the biggest rivalries right here, right?
Right.
And so, to Green Bay, if you were to ask them, what's your out-group? There's two options,
right?
There's Minnesota, the Vikings, and there's the Bears,
right? It's always funny because I do that exercise with my class when we talk about things in communication. You know, the rhetorical terms, like Kenneth Burke calls them God terms and devil terms, right? And so I always ask them, okay, so God terms are kind of like this thing that's an unquestioned good, and devil terms are these things that are unquestioned bad, like interception for you right now.
Yes.
You know, what do these terms mean? And so they get really animated when they start talking about devil terms, I've noticed, because they get to, like, you know, call it Ditka and, you know, Soldier Field and stuff like that. I've had to tell them to kind of take it down a notch sometimes because it's like, you know, we're not really calling them the devil here, but, you know, the nuance gets lost sometimes in the conversation. But it is kind of interesting because, you know, you almost had a couple times there too. The nuance does it kind of interesting because I've noticed that, you know, being from Michigan, while I've kind of, I have a very difficult relationship with the Lions. I am a very, very big, diehard, dyed-in-the-wool Tigers fan. Because I love baseball and I love my Tigers. But, and part of that is a regional thing. I don't like the White Sox in part because I kind of feel like Chicago gets all of this sort of, like, press and all this sort of attention. I don't like Cleveland. Well, I don't like Cleveland for a lot of reasons, but one of them is that, you know, there's that kind of Michigan-Ohio rivalry, and it's all based on really nothing more than just geography, right? And so it's just kind of interesting how quickly we fall into this sort of tribalism.
Right. Yep. And it's so much of it. I mean, there's reasons why we choose the group that we choose to participate in, everything from where we ended up kind of growing up. But
It's hard to talk and do this at the same time, but it worked out okay for you there.
But, you know, we end up, there's a lot of reasons why we choose the group, and you know, and like I said, it's upbringing, it's the community you live in, and things like that. That's one of the things that's interesting. People ask me all the time, well, why, you know, you live in Green Bay, why do you still support the Vikings? And while I get that, I would also question in return, if you were to move to Chicago, would you suddenly become a Chicago
fan? Right. Yeah, it's hard to give those things up, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, when I went to school in Oklahoma, they didn't have a football team because, you know, it was the Sooners. Like, you know, that's that they don't need an NFL team because they would, how could they compete? You know, there's the Cowboys was the big one. It's like, I'm not going to suddenly become a Cowboys fan because I live geographically closer to this thing, right?
Right.
So geography only goes so far.
Right. And so, you know, it ends up being about those connections. But then once you do, it's really rooted in this, you know, kind of, okay, so once you're part of a group, mm-hmm. regardless, and groups are actually something that are kind of tough to define sometimes, mm-hmm. right? You know, it's, you know, psychologists more or less define it as this idea is like, okay, multiple people with a common purpose and a common identity and so on with a common goal.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, but at the same time, so I mean, if we were to use that definition, you know, me and the people I take the bus with in the morning are a group, mm-hmm. right?
We right, right.
Common identity. And I think most of the time, no, we wouldn't think of that as being and so we wouldn't think of them as being a group in the same way, but now if that same bus were on its way to a Packer game,
mm-hmm.
and you know everybody there was a Packer fan,
mm-hmm.
then it does become a group with a common purpose and
right.
a common enemy.
Yeah, and that common enemy is interesting because, and this is where we mention, I think I'm required to mention this every time your name comes up, you are a nationally recommended, nationally recognized expert on the subject of anger. And so that kind of brings to mind, like, because there is a lot of anger at the core of sports.
Right.
It's almost like a sanctioned form of anger or like a socially acceptable form of it, because I'm thinking here, you know, and I could go ahead and like pull on the band-aid or like, you know, reopen the wound of some questionable, you know, plays and calls and decisions made by you know, made against the Packers or something. But I remember like the Lions, like they were like there's the one time I think Calvin Johnson was supposed to caught a ball but it didn't get ruled a catch and so they lost the game or something like that. That kind of thing is fascinating because people get vehemently angry about something that technically doesn't really
right.
influence their life all that much, no. right?
Yeah, and that's, you know, I agree, and I will actually pull a Band-Aid off.
Please do.
And that's Fail Mary, you know,
mm-hmm.
the Seattle interception down. And I think that what you saw from that, I mean, the outrage that mm-hmm. you saw online, and you know, I'll acknowledge from the outset that was one of the worst calls I've ever seen,
mm-hmm.
and so I'm not. But the outrage that you saw,
yeah.
from the public, I mean, Twitter absolutely exploded that night. And part of what I study is how people express their anger online,
right?
And so I actually turned immediately to Twitter to see what was the Twitterverse was doing that night, and
mm-hmm.
the explosion. I mean, there were more tweets after that call for the next hour than there were in the entire game up
right.
until that point. And you know, they weren't congratulatory.
No, of course not.
So, you know, and a lot of what's going on with that, I mean, so there's a lot of reasons why people get mad about sports.
Mm-hmm.
And it has to do with everything from kind of, one, we elevate the status and meaning. You know, it becomes a bigger deal in our heads than
mm-hmm.
it actually is
right.
In reality.
And you know, I certainly don't want to say I'm above that. Like, that's mm-hmm. the thing. Sometimes, like, in academia, you kind of get this feeling. People think, well, you're just talking about this stuff like you're not actually affected by it. Like, literally, there's not a single person alive, I think,
mm-hmm.
that I would not, like, tackle to the ground or just, like, you know, completely sell down the river if my Tigers could win the World Series, right?
Right.
Does it matter? Does it affect my life in any meaningful way? Absolutely not. But I want it so bad that it's like, if it's between that and, I don't know, you, I'm sorry, but I gotta take the World Series.
I can still remember how devastated I was at the So I was at the 1998 NFC Championship game in Minnesota against Atlanta. Kicker missed his Johnson. Is that him?
I can't remember.
Missed his first missed field goal of the season. You know, and I was beyond. Oh,
whoa! You might want to do something.
I couldn't figure out what button I was supposed to push to run. I was beyond devastated, and part of it is that I'd elevated the status and meaning of that game. I'd said things to myself like, this is their best chance of winning a Super Bowl. This is the best team they've ever had, and things like that. So in my head, this game meant so much more than it actually did. And just to illustrate that, because part of what happened, I remember losing sleep the night before, mm-hmm. thinking about that game and thinking about how Atlanta was the best team to beat them, that because of how they matched up. And so there's this tension that goes into it that I bring in based on that elevated status. And then the burging that we just described is another example of what we're talking about. That once you identify with the team, it feels personal.
Right.
The unfairness of bad calls, and there's this perception of unfairness or a lack of that we know tends to bring that stuff up. The other big part, though, is an issue of. Honestly, for some people, it's sort of a secondary gain or increased stakes. It's like, and we bring this on ourselves. We decide that by smack talking.
Right.
So let's say that for the week before the Packer Vikings game, you and I just talk smack for the entire week. Well, now I've added something new. I've added my pride to the mix.
Yeah, you've written a check with your mouth.
Exactly.
And now these guys have to cash it.
Exactly. And so it isn't just a loss that affects their record anymore. It reflects what my Monday is going to be like at work. And,
So. Generally, you don't want to go backward.
Yeah, okay. Now I know. So, I've exacerbated that. Or, you add two other real common components here. One is gambling.
Yep.
So now you've got actual financial stake. And then, frankly, a form of gambling is... fantasy football.
Right.
You added that to the mix, and so there's all of these other, we elevate the status, we elevate all this, and so naturally people get mad, right?
Right.
They get upset when their team loses, when they lose, and when they win, they get happy.
Mm-hmm.
And we haven't, this is not something that has accrued a whole lot of research, because
It worked out okay. I've seen worse.
So, but I think it's not something that's accrued a lot of research, but we see some evidence that immediately following and even the day after following games, people oftentimes will
use the stick to kind of point in the direction, like you can kind of nudge it over to the right.
Oh, that's real bad.
That's going to... Oh, no, that went through. How about that?
way to make that one.
Yeah, that one.
Yeah, I'm not gonna bring up the Seattle one.
No,
bring up my own. we exacerbate that stuff, and we make it so much worse than it really is.
Right. But yeah, the fantasy football thing is interesting because now it's almost in a way. Kind of the ultimate form of gambling, because you are literally just saying, okay, I understand this game well enough that I think these particular players are going to do this well on this particular time, and so I'm going to put together the exact right combination of players to be better than you. And it's so weird because, like, it's almost more abstract and kind of nothing than Madden is, right? Because, like, we're right now playing a fictitious version of an actual sport, which is barely being a human being at the as it is, right? But now fantasy football just says, okay, it's that, but it's a spreadsheet,
right?
So it's I've always kind of thought it was funny to think of fantasy football as D&D for jocks, and I don't see anything like I've played fantasy football. I like it. I don't see anything that dissuades me of that notion.
Well, and you know, if you want to know a great example of a lot of the stuff we're talking about is, have you watched the show The League?
I have watched The League. I'm very familiar with The League.
I'm a big fan of that show for a lot of reasons, but one of the things I really like about it is you get a sense of that elevation of the status of the game, what it means, and then how they, all those things I was just talking about how they increase the
I keep forgetting I'm running.
How they increase the status of the game and how they therefore increase their emotional toll it takes.
Yeah, and except that is a particularly interesting thing because even though it's played for laughs, like that's a very serious phenomenon. And my read of the show, and this is how I've always kind of looked at it in my head, is that these people are ridiculous cartoon monsters to each other during the season, but they're probably perfectly normal any other time of the year.
Well, it's actually, in a lot of ways, it's kind of consistent with what I was talking about before about connections, that, you know, that this is, it's also, you know, they all went to high school together by and large, you know, or they're to one of the, so they have these long-standing relationships. That I think influence, how they feel. And so there's like this connection. I mean, the league is much more than just a fantasy football league. It's their group of friends and how they engage.
Right.
And I think that's a lot of times for people what sports are.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just the team. It's how they like to spend their weekend.
It's kind of a social lubricant in a way. Yeah.
Yep. It's how they stay.
So I noticed that's certainly part of why I started following sports more, is that it gives you something to talk about with people that you might not otherwise have anything to talk about. Because, like, you know, I could go on and I could have these long conversations about, you know, Star Wars or whatever. Mm-hmm. And most of the time I'll just get a blank stare. I just went into halftime with the league.
Right.
Okay. But, you know, I could not have that conversation with just anybody on the street here in Green Bay. But I could say something about, how about that Eddie Lacy run yesterday? And people would be like, yeah, it was so cool, or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to me, is kind of what I think is fascinating about sports in a lot of ways, is that, for all this kind of, and it's very easy to get caught in that kind of, like, whole jock nerd mentality. And I see a lot of people still doing it, like, you know, you have the people online who call it sports ball and kind of like minimize and deflect the importance of it, which, okay, let's be honest, it's inherently ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
We are watching grown men in costumes run around a field and throw this in pursuit of this ball, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is not to disparage the work these men do. It is very difficult work. But the goal itself is kind of inherently silly, right? But I think, you know, a lot of the stuff we've been talking about shows that there, you know, there is this serious dimension to it that kind of goes beyond simply, I like to watch the games, or I have a particular favorite player, or a particular favorite team, or something like that.
Right.
I like how Jordy Nelson just sort of becomes magnetically attracted to the ball, if you notice that.
Yeah.
Which I think that's how it works in real life. That kind of brings up another point, and that's this thing I was wondering about, this question of people. Oh no! Oh no!
Wait.
You gotta run that way! You gotta run that way!
Oh no, don't go out of bounds, though.
Oh, that was pretty good. the idea of sports fandom is almost kind of like a proxy for other, and we sort of touched on this a little bit, but I want to come back to it. Not so much about, like, geography or anything like that, but about, like, social issues, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, I, as a baseball fan, I have often made that argument, well, you know, the Yankees are terrible, or the Cardinals are terrible because, the Yankees are terrible because they buy championships, right? They just, they sink all this money into it, and that's the only reason they've ever won anything, is because they have all this money because New York's a huge media market. The Cardinals are terrible because they represent everything that I hate about baseball, which is like this kind of like stubborn tradition, like, you know, clinging to like the right way to do things and that sort of thing. And in a real sense, neither of these are specific or endemic to these teams. They're just a symptom or a representative of a larger problem, like, you know, respectively, like, you know, income distribution, and also just like this kind of like refusal to accept modernity, right? So I wonder what you thought about that, like this idea that sports almost become kind of like a proxy war for culture in a way.
Yeah, I can see some of that. You know, I'm having a hard time coming up with examples right now, but I can see
I mean, you can just say that I'm brilliant and just move on. That's okay, too.
No, I was actually thinking about how, you know, so much of it, so my mind immediately kind of moves to anger and why. And so much of it is, you know, we have almost unwritten rules. Like, there's a right way to win.
Right.
You know, and that right way to win, it doesn't matter if you're following the rules that the league has set up. You also have to follow my rules. And my rules are that you can't, you know, you can't buy a team. You can't.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Well, you didn't lose anything on it, at least.
Yeah, I thought he fumbled.
Because he dropped the ball. Or he threw it just before he got hit.
That's good.
Yeah, cause the Cardinals, I remember they came after this one guy, Yasiel Puig. Because he flipped his bat after he hit a triple that like kept his team in a championship game. And I'm just like, well, of course you would. Why wouldn't you do that? Because you're excited, you're young, it's your rookie season, and you just saved your team. But they're like, that's not the right way to play baseball. And it's just like this kind of, okay, now I have to get serious.
I like that.
Yeah.
That's something. All right. I think that's it. It's like there are essentially these rules that we kind of have. I mean, I remember once the Vikes went for a touchdown in a game, I think, against Dallas. Maybe they went for two or something at a time where it sort of struck a lot of people as, ah, why did you do that?
Mm-hmm.
Made a lot of people mad, but it has to do with... Oh,
yeah, I roughed the kicker by mistake.
So I think, you know, those unwritten rules that we've kind of created.
So you can either accept or decline. It ends up the same way either way.
I'm going to accept it.
Of course you will. So these unwritten rules anyway.
Yeah, these unwritten rules, they essentially they make us mad in the sense that it's like, well, this is what I said. This is how I said people should play. And because I said that, they need to do X, Y, and Z, and then I get mad when they don't do it.
Right. Now, but I've also noticed that kind of along those lines, you'll notice with sports fandom that, let's say that a player from the Packers were to, God forbid, do something terrible. Okay?
It's never happened.
Never happened. Ever.
But let's just imagine.
Yeah. They decide, the fans are like, well, however terrible this thing is, you know, it doesn't really matter. It's not that important in the grand scheme of things. Or the same thing happens with a Vikings player or whatever. Because I don't want to call any one particular team to the carpet because this is a universal phenomenon. And so, like, you know, we've seen several high-profile cases recently of players in the NFL and other sports who have done some pretty terrible things, right? You know, like... and I'm not just saying this because you're wearing the outfit, but, you know, we have, of course, Adrian Peterson, Ray Rice for the Ravens.
Randy Moss.
I mean,
that's not nearly as bad, but I think for Green Bay, a lot of the thing that's really salient is the mooning incident, which is nowhere near the level of the other two things you described.
And honestly, like, if I am in favor of mooning. Players mooning. Like, I think we should have more fun with this inherently ridiculous stuff, right? If I was watching a game, one of the opposing team wanted to moon the Packers, that's hilarious. Go for it. I don't care. That's just kind of my own personal. I'm here for the laughs. I don't know. But you know, when this stuff happens, I've done some research on this. I was actually looking into Michael Vick, and I wanted to look specifically at kind of the dimension of the coverage in sort of. How the newspapers and magazines and that sort of thing talked about his return to football after the dogfighting stuff. And, you know, because he came back and he did pretty well, actually, for a little while. And what I found was that when they talk about, like, this question of redemption and him kind of making up and atoning, a lot of it was just tied to the fact that if he's good enough on the field, that's how they feel that this guy's going to be able to make up the difference. And so I wonder what your thoughts were on that. If in fact you have any thoughts on this question of why do we forgive certain players or whatever if they're associated with our teams more readily than we do others?
The answer to that question for some is going to be have a little bit to do with that in-group out-group thing that we're talking about. That we're way more likely to forgive someone that's in our group,
right?
If you see them as part of it, is we're more accepting of. Kind of human faults,
right?
If we can identify them,
right?
You know, and so, and that's going to be true anywhere. I mean, the best example of that is probably politics, mm-hmm. right? Where you can look at their candidate, and when they do something, it's like, yeah, see, that's just ooh.
That was a dagger.
You can say, you know, well, their candidate does something, and, mm-hmm. and our gut response is, well, yeah, that's the kind of person they are.
Right.
Our candidate may do almost mm-hmm. the same thing, and our gut response is, yeah, well, you know, he or she misspoke.
Yeah.
Or
but what about the other guy?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Or we point to all the instances in that person's past that mm-hmm. illustrate that they're a good person. You know, mm-hmm. as we do the same thing with athletes. It's, you know, okay, so-and-so did something terrible, but he is a, or she is a, you know, has been a pillar in the community mm-hmm. and, you know, gives a lot to, how do I?
Oh, that's how.
Okay.
You can also just, like, stay in the end zone. He'll just kneel down. Yeah.
You know, so-and-so has been this great member of the community, is given to cause X, Y, and Z. But ultimately, you know, the answer to that, too, is a question of how good they are.
Yeah.
And I will admit, you know, the marketing piece, and you can probably better speak to this than
sure.
I can, but that is, I think, the degree to which we think, you know, the degree to which the powers that be want us to forget and
right.
are willing to keep talking about that, and or let us just kind of...
He got it. Well, because I'm thinking, and also, too, I feel like, do you think that the level of the transgression has anything to do with it, too?
I do. The type of transgression mm-hmm. certainly does. Although, man, we've seen some pretty terrible stuff that we've been willing to forget.
I've noticed...
I'm saying we in the general.
Yeah, not as fans of these particular teams, just as a general... point of view. Now, because I'm thinking right now, this course, as we're recording this on August 29th, 2016, one of the big stories right now coming out of the NFL is, of course, Colin Kaepernick refusing to stand up for the national anthem for political reasons. Now, you know, I'm not really interested in having the conversation, is he right, is he wrong on here, because that's really not our place to have this conversation when we're just sitting here playing video games and talking about sports. But, That to me is kind of interesting, because I've noticed there's almost like a disproportionate level of vitriol for something like that,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to, you know, players cheating or committing off the field transgressions or something like that, right?
Oh,
you got it just back in time. And I think at that point it almost transcends sports, right? It's almost not about the athlete or the sport.
Well, this is a great example of, because so much of it is, this is a question of how we are, and again, using the global sense, but how people choose to interpret that behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, if you, for example, if your appraisal is to think of this as an attack on the military.
Right.
I think how some people are mm-hmm. attributing it or praising it mm-hmm. is an attack on the military. Then I think that you have a different response
mm-hmm.
In that, you know, you get angry, you think it's unpatriotic, you think of it all these things.
Mm-hmm.
If you think of it as a statement designed to draw attention to an issue, you have a very different emotional response.
Right.
You know, maybe it's still anger mm-hmm. because of how you feel about that issue?
Yeah, like maybe he could have done it differently, or maybe, right. you know, like the issue itself is what makes you angry.
Right. But so I think that's what is really driving things, is I think for many people,
mm-hmm.
they are appraising this as an attack on patriotism.
Right.
An attack on America,
mm-hmm.
you know, and military in particular. It's like, how dare you? There are people who fought and died for you,
mm-hmm.
and you can't even stand for them.
Well, and it's that particular case is interesting in light of the fact that the NFL has, you know, received a lot of money from the U.S. military and the Department of Defense for that specific reason, to kind of like promote recruitment and that sort of thing, right? So it's a fascinating topic, and again, I'm not trying to like come down right or wrong on any of it. You know, certainly I have my personal perspective, you have yours, but it does kind of show how when we talk about fandom, we talk about, like, again, it comes back to that whole idea of, like, sports is kind of a proxy for other issues.
Right.
Now, I did want to catch one more thing here before, because I know we're kind of in the last few minutes of the game. You mentioned specifically something you want to talk about, because you actually wrote a blog post about this a few years back. There is a long-standing, I guess you'd call it urban legend at this point.
Because I would call it a myth, but with a caveat.
Okay. So the idea is that, you know, since you are, of course, the anger researcher, that issues of domestic violence spike on Super Bowl Sunday.
Yep.
Right? The implication being that presumably men get very angry about the sport, they take it out on their family. Now, you're very skeptical about this.
I am sort of skeptical about this. Now, there's going to be two caveats to what I'm about to say. One is the fact that, understandably so, domestic violence centers are very, very careful with data about who, you know, about their numbers. And so we don't have a real clear sense of what numbers are like for domestic violence. So it all comes from surveys and things like that.
Right.
The other caveat is that there is actually some data to suggest that that we see an increase in domestic violence.
So you can accept or decline this.
Oh, jeez, here we go. There is some evidence to say that we see an increase in domestic violence on Super Bowl Sunday. The other caveat is it's a very slight increase, and it's also consistent with what you see on all holidays.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm putting holidays in quotes because I'm not sure everyone agrees that Super Bowl Sunday is a holiday. But
It's close enough. It's a secular holiday, I'd argue.
Right.
Sure.
So what you see is a tendency of there's a lot of things that go into holidays that actually cause some relationship problems in the home, so for example, people having parties, elevated expectations for how meaningful the day is, alcohol, and a host of things like that that tend to increase the kind of anger that people can experience, which can lead to domestic violence.
Right.
So it's I wouldn't necessarily call it a flat-out myth, though I'm not sure the data really supports the idea that it's the Super Bowl itself that is leading to that so much as all
just the nature of what the day is and the what goes into it. Okay, I find that interesting because I was always kind of doubtful about that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think almost in a weird way it trivializes a very real issue.
Mm-hmm.
Like saying that, oh, well, they're just mags, their sports team lost. Well, you know, when we talk, and not to bring it too down and get too heavy, you talk about domestic violence, it's not like stuff like that's used as an excuse or a way to kind of, by the abuser, usually sort of like explain away very kind of underlying problems,
right?
Like very sort of like very troubling things that they think and they view, like, you know, their sort of perspective on the world.
Right.
So that so I'm glad that we've more or less debunked or been more skeptical about that.
Yeah. And it, you know, that like anything related, I mean, we're not seeing a whole lot of research on that. So that comes; those findings come from a 2003 effort in communications, the original article. But it's not even an article; it's a conference presentation.
Right.
So we haven't seen a whole lot of data. So, by and large, I'd say jury's still out. But the evidence we have says that that's probably not what's going on.
Okay. Well, there you go. Right here. You got that information from watching these two guys play video games.
Yes.
Which is, again, so other thoughts you have about sports fandom or things in general that we haven't covered? Because I think we've covered a lot of things so far, and we've still got a couple minutes left.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. That's not going to help me at all.
Oh, he looks mad.
He looks very mad.
Yeah, not this guy. This guy looks
bad. No, he's happy. He's
good
very
job,
good. Yeah, Greenway.
Nicely done, Chad.
Yeah.
Playing his last year.
Yeah. Well, if he can do that, he'll probably be happy.
Yeah. Presumably.
Is he going to do it in slow motion now?
Yeah.
No, thank you. I'm good. No, he sped up right before he hits him.
not too much. I mean, I can go into some tips. Some, you know, especially anger-related stuff. I mean, I think for people who find themselves getting too caught up I'm going to share a kind of a sad story, but I'll make it not sad.
Okay.
When I first started...
Yeah, it's already gotten a little heavy.
Yeah. So when I first moved to Green Bay, you know, I didn't get to watch the Vikings that often. Mm-hmm. I was watching a game, and I got animated at one point. I don't even remember it. Honestly, it could have been both good news or bad news based on how I tend to watch and think about sports. And
you guys might not want to watch the end of this. Oh, that was disappointing. That was very disappointing.
So I can't tell who that is. Oh, Jafar. Anthony Carr. So I yelled. I jumped, danced around the room, something like that. And my... I looked over, my dog was kind of cowering a little bit, and it was just a little bit of a wake-up call to me that, like, you know how, and at the time I didn't have children, but it was concern about how my kids would react to me watching sports and how they would interpret the dancing and singing and yelling and stuff like that. And so it's one of those things where I think, you know, I gave some thought to whether or not I should care as much as I did.
Sure.
And I think the conclusion I came to is it's okay to get invested, but once you start feeling like it's causing relationship problems with friends because of smack talking, whether or not you find yourself losing sleep, you know, getting frustrated, whatever, start to think about how you're handling it. And for some people, I say, you know what, stop watching. I realize that's hard to stomach.
Well, it's and you kind of almost feels like. Trust me, I know enough Lions fans. It's like you should have just given up the ghost a long time ago.
Right.
Only heartache lies this way, but that you can't stop. It's like it almost becomes this like vestigial part of you.
Right.
For a lot of the reasons we talked about. I'm gonna come back and try to win this.
Okay.
It's gonna happen.
All right.
I'm gonna call a timeout. I'm gonna come back and try to win this.
Yeah, I don't even know how to do it.
Yeah, you just hit this, but I should have probably told you.
No, it's all right.
You're doing fine.
So
here you were worried you wouldn't be able to do this.
I think you might be being nice to me, and I appreciate that.
Yeah. I was for a while, but now it's just inexcusable.
Oh, come on. Oh,
that was a nice try.
I would like that. I think for some it's also just a question of, you know, thinking about it, I mean, one of the things I'd say is, you know what, if smack talking makes it worse for you, it means that you end up, you know, worried about your prize, like that. Don't do those things. And just sort of make a conscious decision to drop that, you know, or if you find yourself having a hard time controlling your emotions, especially if alcohol is involved, stop drinking while you watch. And so I think there's a host of things people can do to make sort of conscious decisions about what kind of fan they want to be.
Right. And that goes, you know, not just at home, but when you're actually out at the games, too. That can sometimes be the scariest thing.
Yep.
Certainly you hear a lot about, like, fans who are like actively aggressive. I think I saw on Deadspin they have this feature where they talk about like why all the different NFL teams are terrible. And there was one where they talk about I think it was a Steelers fan flipping off a baby or something like that because they were wearing the wrong onesie. I can't remember the exact context, but it was like maybe it's time to think about your life a little bit at that point, right?
Flipping off a baby.
Maybe that's the bright line. Maybe that's where you're like I should reconsider my choices in life.
You know, something interesting happens. I'm curious to know. You may know something about this, but so I've attended a handful of Packer Vikings games at Lambeau Field, where I've worn Viking stuff and obviously been a Viking sports. And you know, many times in that experience, I've had people come up to me and say, "Welcome to Lambeau Field. You know, have a good time. Hope you enjoy the day," or whatever. And to the point that it actually strikes me as somehow there's either a written or unwritten rule amongst Green Bay fans that is kind of how you, how you handle people when they come visit. And it's
Oh no!
Touchdown! If this was Seattle, that's good news.
Savor this while you can. I don't think this is gonna happen this year.
Yeah. So, you know, I think there is something there that I appreciate that I appreciate, you know, as a fan. You don't want to.
Yeah, you can probably just run off the clock at this point. Well, there you go. But yeah, so a lot of interesting thoughts on sports fandom, and of course, you know, we can talk about this and a lot of other great things in psychology. And psychology is one of the many areas that I feel informs game studies. So I'm glad we're able to have this kind of conversation, because we talk about sports, we talk about games, we're talking about something that's kind of a microcosm of the larger human condition. So definitely, thank you very much for coming, and congratulations. And again, I don't think this is going to happen for real, so I'm glad that you had this moment.
Where was this game? Were we in Lambeau?
This was actually in Lambeau, yeah, and I've been to Lambeau enough. It's pretty close to accurate.
That's like the kind of tunnel vision I have. I didn't even notice.
Yeah, you're so focused on winning. All right, well, thanks again, Ryan.
You bet,
much appreciated.
You bet. That was fun.